good big music, get you guys revved up, you know, because tax is such a thing that you need to keep your eyes open. But here we go, but I didn't have music, so I'm going to skip that forward. Now, who are we actually? I actually come from a very commercial background. I used to be a finance director and a controller for a number of companies back in London in the heydays, and thought of deciding to start my own practice in 2005. And obviously my first client was Ravi, Jay. And together we actually started our business, and we've organically grown over the years, almost now 13 years, 12 to 13 years. So having organically grown, we're kind of a big team now. We're centrally based in Milton Keynes, with a team of 8. And we got a very good outsourcing unit also in India. Not a big one, but we're starting to get all our back office jobs done in India basically, so that we can concentrate more on our clients here in Milton Keynes and in London. And you can actually visit my website and see who my team members are and what we actually do and where we come from. Like every accounting services, we tend to provide all the different services that an accountant is looking for, right from starting your business all the way to managing your tax affairs, your personal affairs, also in relation to your insurances and all that kind of stuff. So I won't go deep into it, but obviously you all know bookkeeping, account preparation and all that, but we specialize in something called Xero. Now Xero is something more into bookkeeping things, and very essential for businesses who are actually going to go digital from next year. So, and those who are our clients tend to get a newsletter from us. So we try to be proactive just to let you know exactly what's happening in the tax world and what changes are happening. So whoever our clients are, they tend to get kind of a weekly tips on what's going to happen in the budget or what's going to happen, what the chancellor is going to say about things and stuff like that. Now, why would anyone want to work with us? I think the reason they want to work with us is that they think that at least they're not a number. Each and every client that comes to me and says, you know what, Akshay, the reason I'm joining you is because I feel like a number in a large organization. I cannot talk to anyone. And as the firm grows, and because I'm a small contractor or I'm a small business, I'm actually pushed down the line, and whoever I tend to talk to is more like a junior. I now get to talk to a partner or kind of a proper accountant. And I need more advice. I need someone to be more proactive. And that's the reason where we actually come in, and we actually tend to benefit out of it. And we tend to speak your language, so we understand exactly where you guys come from and what actually you're looking for. Obviously, tax saving is one of them, but also how meticulously you can actually prepare your financials and keep them up to date. So that's one of the main things that we actually excel in. And, okay, great. Now, I'm sure you guys know who this guy is, right? He's made life hell for a lot of businesses. Look at him smiling. He's got a cheeky smile, isn't he? Yeah. But what he has done is, he has really, I would say, the screw word for the businesses. Now, I'm sure you all are aware of those allowances that you get in relation to your dividends. The final allowance. Happy days, isn't it?
Yeah.
Get excited, it's going down. £2,000 from next year. So more tax to pay. So he's increased your tax by 2025. And those guys of you who are actually sole traders or partnership, he's increased your national insurance from 9% to 11%. So he's doing some really nasty things. And I think I know why he's doing it, because it's all about Brexit. He wants to get more and more money in relation to the Brexit thing. Right, what I'm going to talk to you about today is I'm going to give you kind of a brief update on budget, property tax changes that are happening, contractor IRS 35 issues. I'm sure most of you won't actually hear about that and what's going to happen in that coming future. Obviously, new public sector rules on IR 35, which one I think that's your main topic. And obviously, tax saving strategies. Oh, taxing that. Brilliant. Right. Now, restriction. Now, I'm sure most of you are aware of those property tax relief that you got on your interest. Now that's going down. That's significantly going down from next year. It's going to be 75% that you can claim as relief. And each year, that is going down by 25%. So by 2021, you can forget your interest relief that you can claim as an expense in your property income. So your property income is going to be completely taxed, right? I'll tell you more about it when we go forward. Introduction of ATED. What does ATED means? That's annual tax on enveloped developments. This has been existing since 2012, actually. No one knew about it because the threshold was so high. What actually happened with ATED was that this was actually set up because of offshore companies who actually started their companies offshore and bought properties in the United Kingdom. And when they bought properties in the United Kingdom, they never had to pay any stamp duty, they never had to pay any CGT, and even when they sold the property, they never had any CGT or IST issues. And the government thought, hold on a minute, this is not right, you know, like if you just open up an offshore company and buy properties in the United Kingdom, you know, so you're having the best of both worlds. So what they did was they introduced ATED. Now ATED actually earlier on had kind of a big, threshold of almost 2 million. So if you had a 2 million property, then you actually entered into ATED. But over the years, it's trickled down to 500,000. So what the government says now is that if you are going to open your own limited company, now you know that's the big thing now, because everybody wants to open their own limited company and start off buying properties through the limited company. So if you have your own limited company and you buy properties through that limited company, and if your amount of the limited company goes above 500,000, you need to file an ATED form. Now ATED is just telling the government that yes, you have commercial or residential property through your limited company and they are actually on rent. If they are not on rent and that is like ideal, then you have to pay an amount of 3,500 starting as a tax bracket. And that goes up as the value of the property goes up. If you don't file your ATED form, you can get fined £100 immediately and £10 per day. So those guys who are thinking of having a limited company, please be careful. That's one of the things that is going to be a hot topic going forward this year. Corporation tax is reducing. Of course, he has to do something. It is getting taken somewhere from there. Now, the reason why this corporation tax is reducing is purely for Brexit. Now, you can imagine, Ireland has got 15% corporation tax. And since we're out of Brexit, its main aim or focus is trying to pull more and more business in. So the tax actually is going to go down from 19% next year to 18% and to 70% following year. So that's his plan. I think if he gets his way, he probably might actually go on to make it 15% to attract more businesses from the Europe actually. Increase in ISA, individual savings account. I'm going to say more of this in later on. But that allowance is increasing to 20,000. I think you guys still have some more time up to 5th of April put more money into your ISA. But what's coming next in April 2017 onwards is LISA. This is very, very important for our children and obviously guys who are under the age of 40. You can actually put a lot of money behind LISA and the government is going to give you almost 20% on top of that. Simplified cash basis accounting. Now this is, as you know, 2018, the government is planning to go digital on all the tax returns and everything. So those guys who are actually earning more than £10,000 on any of their trading income or property, they will have to submit their tax returns 4 times in a year rather than 1 time that we do actually at the moment. And that's the reason the government is going digital. So what I mean by digital is that what the government says that give us your bank account, give us everything, we'll do everything for you. Or, and we'll also provide you with the software, or if you have an agent or something like that, go through them and let them file your tax returns every year. The reason they're doing this again is in order to claim the tax earlier on. Because what happens usually is that we tend to file our tax return end of the year, and we end up paying tax right in the end of the year. So what the government wants to do is get collect money as fast as possible. And that's the reason. Now, simplified cash basis accounting is basically what the government says is that we don't want you to do all those accruals and all those preparing the balance sheet and all that kind of stuff. Just get your bank statement, get your cash, prepare your accounts on cash basis and let us know what your income was, what your expenditure is, we'll let you know what your tax is going to be. So that is something which is coming in next year. Well, I'm not sure if you guys are into your own businesses, but if you have your own business premises, we are having business rate relief from this year. So anybody who actually has got kind of premises and you got a rateable value of £12,000 of your premises, then your rates are completely free. And that's from £12,000 to £15,000. And I think between 12,000 and 15,000, obviously there's a kind of a tapering thing. Up to 15,000 pound, it might go down to probably 0%. But more than 15,000 rateable value, also the rates are coming down. So what the government is trying to do is support the businesses in order to, how do we say, increase their profile. Because you might see in London and everywhere, a lot of shops are closed. And the reason they're closed is purely because of business rates. And that's the main thing why this has come up. FRS scheme to be removed, I think that's wrong actually. Not to be removed actually, it's been altered. FRS is a flat rate scheme in relation to your VAT. Again, the government has found out that we contractors tend to make a lot of money out of this scheme, you see. So they found that loophole and they want to solve that. So they've come on the, I'll explain more on that later on. Class 4 NIC is increased from 9% to 11%, as I earlier said. This is for purely for sole traders. This is trying to bring them in line with the, what do you call, employed people. So they're going to be abolishing the Class 2 national insurance, which I don't know if you guys are aware of. You were paying £2.50 or £2.75 earlier on. That's getting abolished. They're trying to increase the Class 4 national insurance. Obviously, Class 4 national insurance, you're going to be paying anything above £7,000. So if your profits are above £7,000, you end up paying the Class 4 national insurance. Earlier said around decrease in nil rate band for dividends. Well, that's coming down from £5,000 to £2,000. So more tax on that. And I'm giving you all gloomy news, aren't I? But that's the future. Sorry, guys. But not all that is gloomy. You know, we don't even have any interest rate in this country. And what the government goes on to do, the first £1,000 of interest you earn is tax free. Now, where are you going to get that kind of interest? Yeah. So that's kind of a caveat actually, just to make people happy. You know, first £1,000 tax free if you're a 20% taxpayer, and if you're a 40% taxpayer, then £500. Yay, we all are happy about that. So that's the budget, which actually happened obviously in March, and those are a short synopsis of what has happened. Right, property tax is from April onwards. As I said earlier on, restriction on interest relief to be reduced by 25% each year, with no relief available up to from 2021. So by 2021, you probably will get no relief at all. And the other rule that is coming in is that if you buy a property and you do it up for rental purposes, you cannot claim that as an expense. Yeah. The second thing is that if you buy a property and you pay solicitor charges and you do all that kind of stuff, you can't claim that as an expense. Yeah. If you do the property up, you put a new kitchen in, you put the new carpets in, no, can't claim the expenses. But what you can claim later on, after a couple of years, is that if you want to change the kitchen or the carpet, it has to be the similar kitchen and a similar carpet. Yeah.
You can't see.
So if your carpet and your kitchen is not similar and you want a fancy kitchen, you want to put kind of a marble on top or anything like that, then you have to pay the additional cost of putting all that cannot be claimed as an expense. So it has to be like for like. Okay, repair and maintenance is still allowed to claim as an expense, but wear and tear is not allowed. So any capital expenditure you do, changing your roof tiles on top of your building or anything else, is not allowed. Yes, they are allowing for you to claim on the double glazing, you put double glazing windows or something like that. But other than that, any wear and tear allowance, they are not going to allow you to claim any expense. So they're getting pretty tough on this kind of stuff. The reason is that they're trying to avoid the kind of landlords, the budding entrepreneurial landlords who actually want to buy properties for future purposes, and try and give more support to the new generation to buy, get on the property ladder basically. And I'm sure you all are aware of the additional stamp duty, 3%, right? Now that 3% on a buy-to-let property is going to remain, and irrespective whether you buy a property through your limited company or you buy a property through yourself, the 3% has to be paid on top. All right, the caveat again is that they are coming up with another thing to discourage landlords. And what that is that, you know, when you sell a property, a buy-to-let property, you've got to make a profit. And you're thinking, okay, I'll probably make a profit and then I'll actually pay my capital gains tax. Yeah? What they want to come up in 2018 is that they want the capital gains tax within 30 days of you selling the property and making a profit on that. Now, usually your capital gains tax, if you're a 20% taxpayer, is 18%. You end up paying 28% on your buy-to-let property. So you can imagine the amount of stress that's going to give you as landlords. But still, property is the way forward. You know, you tend to get capital appreciation of it. Where else can you invest? In stock and shares and mutual funds? So it's still a lucrative business, but yes, they want their chunk of money. The government wants their chunk of money from that. I did explain to you about using limited company in relation to the ATED returns each year. This is very, very important. People who are actually having properties through the limited company, please file your ATED or annual tax envelope development returns if your property is above £500,000. If you want to cluster properties. Right, now this question I tend to get asked all the time. All the time I tend to get asked this question. You know, a client comes to me and says, actually, you know what? I'm a contractor. I tend to make a lot of money, right? Okay, I've bought properties with me and my wife. And my wife doesn't do anything. She's, you know, she just helps me out in home, and obviously I've got two small children, so she can't do much. She can't go out and work. So her personal allowance is completely being wasted and she's at home. But whereas I am actually a 40% taxpayer. I say, okay, so, but I've got three properties, right? And those three properties are joined between me and my wife. So when I actually have to file my returns, I have to file the 50% profit that I make through those properties, and I end up paying 40% tax as compared to my wife just paying 20%. And she's got a lot of allowance left. What can I do? So don't worry, guys. We have a solution to that. Yeah, a lot of people have come for that. And that is called as declaration of trust and deed. So we tend to help people in relation to that. So we file a declaration of trust and deed, file a form 17 with the Indian Revenue, and make sure that we actually try and shift most of the income that you 40% guys are paying into your wife's name. So claim that. We're trying to bring we can negotiate some rates with the solicitors in order to prepare the declaration of trust. Now, what this declaration of trust means is that you're actually transferring most of the property into your wife's name purely for the income shifting purposes. It is allowed. There's nothing that is illegal. It is completely legitimate as far as the HMRC is concerned. But what needs to be done is that this kind of declaration of trust needs to be revoked when you actually sell your property. So it is very, very important that that thing happens, and you have to inform the Inland Revenue on Form 17 that you are now revoking this, and then you are bringing a thing in like that when you actually sell the property. This is purely to claim the allowance that your wife is losing out on. So if anybody has any issues on that one, needs to talk to me, please feel free to talk to me about that particular. Right, transferring property. Now a lot of people, you know, they come to me and say, actually, you know what, I've got this property, I want to set up a limited company, and I want to transfer all my property to a limited company, and you know, and then go to the bank, tell the bank I've got so many properties and I've got so much equity in the properties and I want to buy property through my limited company. I said, oh, sounds good and, you know, happy dory, but have you guys thought about your stamp duty transfer? No? And have you thought about CGT? So when you're transferring a property, you're actually selling a property from yourself into a limited company. Because people tend to forget the limited company is actually a separate entity, right? And they think it is their themselves, but it's actually a separate entity. So when you're transferring a property from a limited company yourself into a limited company, you end up paying a CGT. So just be careful. If you have property more than £175,000, I would suggest don't do that kind of stuff. I want to make it more interactive kind of seminar. So if you have any questions in the meantime, please feel free to ask. I'll tend to continue on this one. So that's all about property tax changes that are happening on April 2017 onwards. I know it did sound bleak, but unfortunately that's where we stand. Changes to IT contractor issues, both public and private companies. Well, at the moment, private companies are very much protected via the IR35, and obviously your agencies are protecting you through their contract, because the onus lies on the agency actually to actually make sure that the contracts are airtight between the contractor and the agency, and the agency and the, what do you call, the company that's providing the service, basically. So, But what the Inland Revenue plans to do is that 6th of April, I'm sure you all are aware that the IR35 issue with public sector is more or less in question at the moment. So if that goes success, they want to roll it down to the private limited companies too. Now, that's a bit worry at the moment, in relation to the public sector, what the draft legislation that came out on 5th of December states that the onus lies not on the contractor to prove that he is inside or outside IR35, but the onus lies with the agency or the end company, i.e. the public sector, right? The public sector then decides whether they want to employ you or what they want to do to you, or it depends on the contractor, whether he wants to stay in the contract or leave the contract, right? Now, there is a chance whereby the contractor can actually go back to the public sector and say, you know what, I'm not making the kind of big money that I used to make as a contractor. Now, since you want to employ me, why don't we renegotiate our rates? So there is an option to renegotiate your rates. But you know what I've been hearing from other sources is that a lot of public sectors are going to hammer on the contractors, and what they're going to do is that they're going to start putting zero-hour contracts. So if they start putting zero-hour contracts on you guys who are actually working as contractors in the public sector, they can only call you when they want to call you. This is to avoid the bench fee. I'm sure you guys are all aware of that. So this is one thing that the public sector might do in order to save money. Because don't forget that taking you on as employees, they have to pay a national insurance at 13.8%. And that's going to be a big chunk for them. And public sector don't have that kind of money, especially the NHS or other public sector. So they might try and put you into zero contract. They might want you to sign a zero contract. So just to be aware of that kind of issue. The other changes that is happening, obviously, in relation to VAT, of course, 14.5% was a magic number where we all made money. Unfortunately, those also is not going away. I could proudly tell my client, you know what? Don't worry about my fees, the VAT will take care of it. You know, like, yeah, you're right, you know, actually I'm claiming back $3,000, you know. I say, yeah, so you see that my fees taken care of. But now that's going away. So now they actually introduced 16.5%, and this is based on limited cost trader. So basically, if your turnover, your cost of turnover is not more than £1,000, you are still better off with the flat rate scheme. But if your cost is more than £1,000, then you're better off going to a cash-based VAT scheme. So there's going to be a kind of a paradigm shift over here, changing from your flat rate to cash basis, if your expenses are more than £2,000. Now don't forget, you know, you guys always think that we're going to be claiming the trial and subsistence expenses. As far as contractors are concerned, trial and subsistence expenses is good for up to 1 year or 1.5 years. After which, if you are with the same employer contracting, you can't claim those trial expenses or trial and subsistence expenses. Other expenses that you have is your own salary, which is the minimum salary that you tend to take on the books. And the other expenses you tend to have is obviously your mobile phones, your internet, and your insurance and all that. Now that doesn't equate to £1,000 worth of expense and plus VAT. Then you're still better off staying with the FRS scheme or the flat rate scheme. Now the factory scheme obviously is 16.5%, so even if you take say £100,000 turnover throughout the year, and you know the £20,000 is a VAT, 16.5% equates to £19,800. So you are still saving £200. So if you can justify that your expenses in relation to VAT are going to be more than £200 or more than £1,000 plus VAT, then you're better off changing your scheme to cash basis, else remain with the FRS scheme. So that is one thing to be noted. If you have your accountants, you can talk to them in relation to that. All right.